I'm happy to bring Sahil Jain up. Sahil is actually an SLC SEM alumni. He was here, I think, a couple years ago. Does that sound right? To one of our monthly events that we did at the Adobe building. Really love what he put together. Sahil is the CEO and co-founder of AdStage, an all-in-one advertising platform that helps marketers manage, automate, and report on their ad campaigns across search and social networks. Sahil co-founded his first company, Y Combinators, an SV angel-backed Trigger.io, at 20. He dropped out of UC Berkeley at the age of 19 to join AOL corporate development and dropped out of high school at the age of 17 to join Yahoo, I guess Yahoo Mobile. And prior to that, Sahil worked in the professional video game industry. He's spoken at leading advertising and business conferences such as Advertising Week's Ad Tech and many others. We're really excited to have him back here in Salt Lake City. Please give a warm round of applause to Mr. Sahil Jain.
All right. I think we're getting the deck set up. Thanks for having me, everybody. Are we good to go? It's really hard to see back there. A lot of lights. All right, now we're good to go. Cool. Okay, well, thanks for having me. I really appreciate it. You know, it's always really interesting coming here to Salt Lake City for me, just because it's crazy to think about how many PPC folks are in this small concentration, which is obviously a near and dear industry to us. And so, just very quickly, my name is Sahil. I'm the CEO and co-founder of a company called AdStage, a typical kind of Silicon Valley VC-backed startup. And what we've done is we built a platform that very simply connects paid marketers to the data they need across paid search, paid social, web analytics, and kind of your custom business metrics. So you've heard a lot of presentations around LTV, CAC, so on and so forth, down funnel metrics. We bring it all together in one place so that you can visualize it, you can automate on top of it, so on and so forth. So we have three products. The reason I'm telling you this is not so that you come and use AdStage, it's because we're gonna be talking about all the data that we've collected and the insights we've found from it. So our three products are really simply, we have a reporting product where you can analyze and report, we have an automation product that you can take action on your paid campaigns, and of course, we have a data API that's kind of essentially under everything. So what we're going to talk about today is, you know, since we started the company, about 5 years ago. And when we started the company, since then we've actually indexed data on about $1.8 billion of ad spend across Google, Bing, Facebook, LinkedIn, and Twitter. So a lot of ad dollars under one roof, and that gives us a really interesting vantage point in terms of being able to see what the trends are at a macro level across these channels, right? So what I'm going to present to you guys today is going to be focused around Q1 and Q2 of this year, specifically around social. So the state of paid social. And what we actually analyzed, let's take a quick look at the inputs. 107 million clicks across Facebook, LinkedIn, and Twitter. 40 different countries, so a pretty global span. And we're gonna show you and kind of walk you through this and kind of understand, you know, how's Facebook doing, how's Twitter doing, how's LinkedIn doing, and what's the true narrative behind all these different social networks. So the inputs across 40 different countries, Facebook, LinkedIn, and Twitter are the networks, agency and in-house data, and then finally, B2B and B2C advertisers. So our stats here, so 57% of our customers today are in-house advertisers, 43% are agencies. So a really healthy mix across both of those. The B2B and B2C mix that you have, 47% being B2B, 22% B2C, and 31% are actually both. So let's dive in to the paid social benchmarks. And what we're gonna do is we're gonna go network by network. So we're gonna start with Facebook. We'll go through the other networks after that. And then we'll end with some conclusions as to what we should do as social advertisers. What should we keep in mind as the market's starting to shift? And certainly as you know, you have this duopoly starting to form between Google and Facebook. So very quickly, before we dive into Facebook stats, Facebook CFO on their recent earnings call back in 2016, one thing that he wanted everyone in the market to know was that things are gonna slow down a little bit, right? Facebook is really maturing, their advertising revenue has been growing, 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 and their spend has continued to grow, don't get me wrong, that's not necessarily slowing down. But their ad load in particular, the amount of impressions that they're serving, so on and so forth, is starting to decrease. Now, a lot of us should know the answer to that and why that's happening. It's a pretty simple reason, right? At some point, Facebook's really, really big. So getting even bigger becomes challenging, and therefore getting more impressions also from an inventory standpoint becomes challenging. So that's why you saw them buy WhatsApp. That's why you saw them buy Instagram. All of these were inevitable moves to make sure that they can increase their audience base, increase the amount of eyeballs that they can serve to you guys, that you guys can pay for. And these are all those different attempts coalescing together to give you an ad platform, right? But at the end of the day, what they know is they, on these earnings calls, you have to be very honest, right? Because you get in a lot of trouble if you're not. And what they're trying to tell you is that be mindful that things are going to slow down a bit. At some point, we're going to catch up to our actual volume. And that's when things start to get very interesting from an inventory standpoint for a lot of us here as performance marketers in terms of the actual cost, right? So 73% of marketers today say they're going to invest more in Facebook, right? Or that they're investing a majority of their budget on Facebook when it comes to social advertising. 71% of those, or 71% in general, are going to actually increase their Facebook spend. They're not just going to keep spending on it, but they're actually seeing results enough, we think, to increase that actual amount of spend. Another stat that's pretty interesting, and this is kind of just crazy to think about, is Facebook's already at 5 million active advertisers on their platform, up from 4 a few months back and up from 3 before that. But what's even crazier is that's only 8% of the 65 million businesses that are active on Facebook. So if you're a business owner, if you're Mark Zuckerberg, you're like, wow, only 8%, that means we have so much more opportunity that we can grow into. But that also means for advertisers that the competition is going to continue to get more intense, right? Which totally affects the auction dynamics, which is what something I'm sure a lot of us here are pretty interested in. So let's dive into the data. So remember, ad stage alone, last year we had about $420 million go through our platform. So it's a lot of money where we can start to look at this data and kind of understand the supply and demand curve across these different channels. So the very first thing we like to look at is very simple, spend versus impressions. And what you can see, and this is a similar trend you're going to see across the board, this is Q1 and Q2 of this year. This is the kind of different, that's a time frame we're going to look at, right? So the idea here is spend is continuing to increase, while impressions are sort of increasing but really staying flat. So we're paying more for the same amount of impressions for that example, right? Things are becoming more competitive, therefore the cost is rising, but people are willing, it's not just budget here, people are willing to spend more for those results. So it must be working, or so we think. Facebook CPMs have increased by 171% if you look at January, beginning of this year, to just June. So in 6 months, you see 171% increase. Facebook ad load slowdown is actually real. So back in 2016, when their CFO was on their earnings call, he did a good job, he earned his money, and he told the truth, and he basically said that the load is gonna start to slow down. You can see that in the impression counts. So Q2 2017 impressions are down. The growth is still positive, but you can see the dramatic difference, right? It slowed down to 19% versus 32% in Q1 17 versus 49% in Q4 16. So you can see it's a pretty dramatic decrease. And if we actually think about it, in terms of if this is going to continue to actually decrease going forward, we're not really sure. Facebook's doing a lot of things, just like other networks, in terms of activating new things like the audience network that some of you may be familiar with, trying to bring online their other properties, like an Instagram, right, or a WhatsApp. So who knows? But this is something to certainly pay attention to. So the next thing we're going to look at is Facebook CPC increase as well, right? So across the board, everything's getting more expensive, and that's something to keep in mind. So the CPC increase has been 136% over the last 6 months alone, if you're looking at January through June. So with this, of course, as kind of alluded to, the prices are going up. So advertisers are having to pay more money for essentially the same results, but they're actually willing to do this. So if you actually look at how advertisers are valuing clicks, it's relatively correlative here, right? So as spend is increasing or as they're getting a larger number of clicks, they're willing to pay the higher CPC or the higher CPM. It's okay to them, and that has to scream to you that the results are in, right? For a long time, 5 years ago when we started the company, Facebook ads were still fairly new, right? And they've really picked up steam in the last couple of years. When we started the company, it was funny because investors used to always us pitching for money, you're on Silicon Valley, going down Sand Hill Road, trying to get a couple million bucks. When you pitch these investors, the number one thing they said to me was, Sahil, why are you building a cross-network platform? Like, no one's gonna advertise outside of Google. That was literally their main reason to not put money in the company. Crazy wrong, right? And so now everyone says, now it's a little bit different. Now the story is, why would you ever do anything beyond Google and Facebook? And that one's a little bit more valid, but certainly not entirely valid, right? And so you're starting to see that kind of information here, but you're starting to see that very quickly in just a few years, Facebook and Google have created a true duopoly, especially when it comes to performance advertising. So the next piece here is the budgets. So just with spend, budgets are also increasing. So despite the price going up on the CPM or CPC side, across the board over the last 6 months, you'll see that people are actually increasing their budgets There are that 71% that said they're going to increase their budget towards Facebook in particular. And there's a huge drop-off for the other social networks as well, right? Now, the one stat that's really interesting here in terms of performance, and granted, I'm not saying this is CPA or even further down the funnel, but CTRs continue to remain pretty flat and actually incredibly tight if you look at the actual numbers, right? So that's not changing, but people are therefore, people are still considering to invest and increase their actual budgets over time. So that's kind of the initial high-level stats that we look at when we look at Facebook. So what are a couple of the insights here that we want to take a look at? So small and mid-sized businesses and brands are jumping to Facebook in droves. So as mentioned, remember, 5 million active advertisers, that's only 8% of the 65 million or odd businesses that are active on Facebook. But as the small and medium-sized businesses continue to flock over there, you're going to have more competition, and therefore prices are going to rise. But again, do we really care? If the results are still working, if you listen to a couple of those Google presentations that were phenomenal, where they talk about down-funnel metrics and really measuring true ROI, if it's still working, if you're still turning a dollar into two on a margin-adjusted basis, then shouldn't we keep investing, right? The next thing here is, as a result, everything is more expensive, and things are climbing pretty quickly. Just look at this year alone. So just imagine, we all know in Q4, things get even more crazy. And so what's it going to look like when we get to Q4? Are things going to skyrocket? Are CPCs going to skyrocket? Are CPMs going to skyrocket? We're not sure yet. And are advertisers actually going to get afraid of the increased budgets? I know AJ is the most excited person about LinkedIn you'll ever meet here. But certainly, you know, he'll tell you that just because the prices are going up doesn't mean it's something that you should shy away from. So a couple of the questions that we would ask Facebook, and we do ask them as a partner, is, are results driving the increase in the budgets, or is it the competitive auction? So what I mean by this is it because people are getting the results they want and therefore they're pouring more money into it, or are they pouring money into it out of necessity just to stay above water compared to the competition, right? That's one question that we should ask. The second question we should ask is, how will advertisers react to the increase in competition, and especially just the increase in price across the board? So a lot of you here might be considering this. If you're running social advertising in general, you're running to Q4, whether an e-com business, CPG brand in general, or anything, right? If you're lead generation, these things matter. Every single cent matters for you guys. I'm sure all of you guys pay attention to every single one of those things, maybe in a spreadsheet or wherever, right? And Q4 is historically more expensive on Facebook in general, and this is pretty certain across every single channel because of the competitive, you know, nature of things in the e-commerce world in general. So are they going to find more inventory? Is WhatsApp going to work? Is Messenger going to work? Is Instagram going to work? There's so many efforts that these guys are pushing out. And if you think about it now, remember when they bought Instagram for $1 billion and we thought it was a ton of money? I mean, come on, look at their ad inventory in general. That was like pennies for them, right? But can they activate that audience? Everyone was curious, why did they buy WhatsApp for, what was it? It was like $19 billion. Well, it was an audience, and more importantly, it was a little bit of a younger audience, younger demographic, but also an international audience, right? And that's where you start to see things change, and we'll talk a little bit about international in just a second. Right, so that's Facebook. So just to give us a basis, right? Now we're going to move into LinkedIn. So LinkedIn, also known as the B2B advertising network, a lot of people do see success here on the B2B side, but we're starting to specialize a little bit more. So on the LinkedIn side of things, 43% of advertisers are not spending on LinkedIn today. And in fact, I think it's only like 7% of advertisers are spending the majority of their budget on LinkedIn. That actually shouldn't be too surprising, right? First of all, it's very, very B2B centric. It is fairly expensive, so your unit economics have to work for you to actually be able to spend on LinkedIn and spend profitably, right? And it's also just a little bit more unique of a beast. They've been bringing together all these different products like InMail, sponsored updates, text ads were interesting, display ads are going away. Now they have an integration into Outlook, so you can actually start to serve stuff through their Microsoft partnership now that they've been acquired. So this is definitely an area to keep an eye on, and certainly if you're a B2B advertiser, if you haven't tried LinkedIn and your price points are high enough, it might be worth it, considering the competition is expanding everywhere. So let's dive into the whole kind of data set here for LinkedIn. So you see the very similar picture. So again, we're looking at spend versus impressions, and you can see that spend has continued to increase, right? And in this case, impressions are actually starting to take a little bit more of a dive. Who knows, it could be seasonality. We'll see in the next two quarters what actually happens. But one thing to keep in mind here is that people are still spending more. Despite it being incredibly expensive, and we'll get into it, it's pretty dramatic in terms of how it is, how it works. But the impressions, it doesn't really phase anybody yet, right? People are still investing. It hasn't hit its peak yet. LinkedIn says that the advertising business, they call it marketing solutions, is their fastest growing business unit in the entire company. Remember, they have Recruiter. I'm sure some of you guys are familiar. They have the talent solutions business. And so that's pretty interesting to note that their ad business is by far their fastest growing business in terms of year-over-year growth. So another thing here, too, is that impressions did drop in Q2, causing CPMs to jump, right? One little kind of annotation here that we put is LinkedIn's also been launching a lot of new product, especially after the acquisition. So they launched the Audience Network, which every network is essentially trying to do to expand audience. I don't know if it'll work. And frankly, when we've tested these, I would love to hear what you guys think too, but when we've tested these extended audience networks, it's been pretty challenging to get, you know, high credibility clicks or high credibility traffic, right? But what else happened is that they also started to launch things like matched audiences. So you hear custom audiences, matched audiences, and everyone has a different name for it, but basically being able to bring your first party data in and start to target on a B2B level. So all these changes might be affecting a slight pickup that you're starting to see. I think it's seasonality. So we've talked about geos and how geos can affect an auction, right? So what's interesting to see here is that we have much, much higher CPMs in smaller countries. Now you might think this is pretty obvious. If you think about LinkedIn, they have about 500 million members. The vast majority are in the US or North America in general, right? Whereas in these smaller countries, so if you look at Australia, for example, you're gonna have a much smaller market, and therefore the competition, of course, is gonna be much higher, and for that reason, you're gonna see the prices jump. So that's not too crazy, right? But if you look at the actual CPCs, these are pretty high, or the CPMs, they're fairly high. It's a fairly expensive auction compared to what we saw on Facebook. So one quick question here to think about, especially for LinkedIn. So Facebook is keen to grow, you know, their vision, take over the world, everybody, you know, we wanna get everybody online. They're even building airplanes that give people Wi-Fi. I mean, they're really trying to activate everyone, right? LinkedIn is not building airplanes, and they're not necessarily activating everyone. If you look at their member growth or the user growth, it's not skyrocketing. It's another similar problem that Twitter has, which has really been part of Twitter's demise in terms of value course correction, right? So if you think about it, is inventory for LinkedIn a problem? And I think it's actually a problem for every single ad network in general. But how big of a problem is it really? Will people stop investing? Will prices become disproportionately high? So another thing to look at too is in Q2, there was a 5% increase in clicks and a 10% increase in ad spend. So you are seeing a similar but more micro pattern that you saw to Facebook, where the spend is going up, the cost is going up, but people are still willing to pay for it. It's a common theme that you're gonna see throughout this. And LinkedIn CPCs still got more expensive, right? So there was 15% in Q2 compared to Q1. Excuse me. So the other thing that we wanna take a look at is CTR. So we always kinda end here, not that CTR is the most important metric, but it's important to note that in CTR in general across the social networks, it continues to remain flat. And it's remained flat for a very, very long time. In fact, I'll give a little bit of a precursor into Twitter, it's like absurdly flat. It's kind of crazy, we've never really seen that, but when you look across about $100 million of data, you can kinda see that in just for a given quarter, the CTRs remaining flat is interesting. So at least from a results standpoint, there's still action happening. There are still some sort of interactions or engagements happening across these channels. So it's not necessary that you want to run away from them despite the price. So let's look at the different insights that we have for LinkedIn. I think I hit the right button. Okay, start over. Or not. All right, I think we're good. All right, advertisers are putting more budget on LinkedIn ads in general. This is similar to Facebook, right? CPMs and CPCs continue to rise. And this is really somewhat nerve-wracking when it comes to LinkedIn side, because as mentioned, LinkedIn's incredibly expensive. We're actually gonna show it to you compared to every other channel. Now, granted, I know that AJ is like shaking his head right now somewhere, but it doesn't matter that necessarily the clicks are more expensive. It matters in terms of what the actual LTV or ROI you get from the campaign. And certainly as really brilliant paid marketers here that I'm sure we have in the audience, we all know that. But it's certainly something, no one wants to pay more for a click necessarily, right? If you can get the same results with cheaper, you know, with a cheaper cost, we're gonna opt for that, of course. And the next piece here too is by using natively uploaded videos as a new ad format, LinkedIn could increase its overall load without cluttering the newsfeed. So one big problem with LinkedIn, I think we're all fairly kind of in the know about video advertising in general and how it's picking up across the board, certainly across Facebook and Twitter. On the LinkedIn side, you can put a video in your advertising, but it's not a native video. So you don't get all the metrics that you'd like to get on it necessarily or the targeting capabilities. But you know, LinkedIn has started flirting with the concept, and certainly some people here might even be trying to use their kind of initial implementation. But could this be one of their solutions? Could this help them get through this phase of cost increase? So the questions that we would ask them is, are LinkedIn's 500 million advertisers, or members, sorry, enough to entice digital advertisers to stick around? But is that number being stagnant going to be problematic for them going forward? Are CPCs scaring away advertisers? I guarantee you there's a decent number of people here who have tried LinkedIn and abandoned it fairly quickly because their CPCs are very high, and that's why it's imperative for them to figure out that full funnel kind of modeling or understanding of cost down through the CRM. If it's lead generation, let's talk about the CRM. Let's get the CRM data actually piping back. Let's get that LTV piping back as well. And so really, as a company, what LinkedIn should do is focus on the technology that enables you guys to better track that. And unfortunately, a lot of the ad networks just don't do that. So when will LinkedIn start serving video ads? Because could this be their saving grace? They launched their audience network. I don't think that's their saving grace. So far, audience networks in general haven't been that great. They're good in terms of serving impressions, but they're not necessarily good in terms of serving actual quality. Great, so we got through LinkedIn. Now let's move on to Twitter, which is a pretty interesting one. So I'm sure a lot of us here have been following Twitter. You probably use Twitter today to tweet something about the conference. But 49% of folks are saying that they're not at all investing in Twitter. And so I'll tell you a really quick story. So obviously we're a partner of Twitter's. And so when I went there, someone fairly high up at Twitter, you know, his main question, he was you know, kind of nice for him to be pretty vulnerable and honest about this. But he basically asked us, he says, hey, so is Twitter working for your advertisers? I said, honestly, I have no clue. Why don't you tell me? Is Twitter working for advertisers in general when you guys look at it from a Twitter lens? His response was honest and I think fairly accurate. He basically said Twitter advertising works 50% of the time, and 50% of the time when it does work, they run out of inventory, right? They just can't get the volume, then an advertiser can't get the volume that they're looking to get. So it kind of works for half the folks, but then when it works, it doesn't work well enough. And you start to see this mirrored in the data that you have put together. So Twitter supply and demand, same thing though, right? People are still investing. Despite this, despite the cost, despite the results, people are investing while the impressions remain somewhat stagnant. CPMs jumped by 40% in Q2 alone. So again, same thing, getting more expensive. What's interesting though is when you look at Twitter from a geo standpoint. So this is actually flipped. So there's actually higher CPMs in their most competitive markets, right? So in the UK and the US, despite there being reasonable volume internationally. Versus in LinkedIn's case, right, the US was probably the most affordable market from a CPM standpoint, and everywhere else was like 4x more. I think Australia was in the 40-something dollars, right? So is Twitter truly a viable channel? So a lot of you guys here that are doing social advertising have almost certainly asked yourselves this, and certainly if you're a brand advertiser, it might be more interesting. They do have native video advertising, so again, could be a little bit more intriguing. If you're a DR advertiser, or direct response, or performance advertiser in general, it can be a little bit more challenging, right? Just to give you a quick example, think about just the ad type for Twitter alone. You have the promoted tweet, you used to attach these cards, which you still kind of do. You could have like five, you used to be able to have like five different links in your promoted tweet. I don't know how you're supposed to track that, right? So what they've been doing in the last year, if you look at Twitter in general, and what hedge funds and stuff are looking at Twitter when they actually try to review their ad products, is they've been cutting everything. So the one good thing that I will say in this case, from a Twitter standpoint, is that they are focusing a lot more on product, and more importantly, they're doing one of the most difficult tasks that any product person has to do, which is cut product, and cut a lot of it, right? And so that's something to also pay attention to. So as advertisers, it's not our job to just look at the numbers, just look at the data. You also want to look at the product itself, right? And how is the product evolving? How is the product roadmap changing? It's not a surprise if you go to any of the summits for these ad networks, like the Facebook Summit or the Twitter Summit or whatever, you'll see that they spend a lot of their time on product roadmap. It's not just about new ad types, but fundamentally, how are they changing things? What interface changes are they making, right? What new types are they making? What's the different changes in targeting and placements? These are all things that we care about because they fundamentally change how we play with this given auction. So let's look at a little bit more of the data. Twitter saw 18% CPC increase in Q2, same exact trend. And the CTR remains, as I mentioned, really, really flat. And this is not a bad thing, it's a great thing. So there's still some results to be had here. It's just a matter of, are they working or not? Are the results that you want to see is the type of customer that you actually want to see? So really quickly, Twitter Insights. Advertisers are still spending on Twitter ads. They haven't gone away yet. It's just, you know, it's one of those networks that just won't go away, right? And it's kind of a necessity. And obviously, like, you know, current election made it even more popular. CPMs and CPCs increased while CTRs remain flat. Exactly the same story as the two other social network counterparts. And there's less volatility in the Twitter auction, right? So these are all kind of decent indications. So why are people freaking out so much about Twitter? They just can't get it to work. Well, a lot of this comes back to measurement. When it comes to the other channels, barring, you know, LinkedIn has their challenges too, you can see that Google and Facebook lead the charge in general in paid. And the reason for this is because they've been the ones that have invested the most in downfunnel measurement as well, attribution modeling, being able to bring in different, you know, downfunnel custom conversions like LTV, CAC, cost per purchase, repeat purchases if you're e-com. All these kinds of methods, they realize that at some point, this room is getting way too smart for just standard traditional advertising that's top of funnel, then you hand it off to salespeople, right? We really care about those down funnel metrics, and in order to truly know, so for us as a VC-backed business, we get $10 million as an investment, and I say I'm gonna spend $1 million a month. My VC should, they probably won't, but they should ask me, hey, if you're gonna spend $1 million a month, that's okay, but how do I know it's actually working? If I get away with saying, well, we're getting a lot of clicks, it'd be pretty frightening. Frankly, you hope they're a little smarter than that. But the idea is to actually show them that I can turn a dollar into two, and I have a reasonable payback period in doing so, right? These are the things that we care about as performance advertisers. So the questions that we have to Twitter are a little bit more rudimentary. Are Twitter ads in general even working? Are we getting the results we need, and can we frankly track those results? Very standard question, but surprising that we still can't answer this question for Twitter, right? Are Twitter ads for brand awareness? Can they really work for DR? Is that something that we can actually, as performance advertisers, leverage as a channel? Or should we use it? Brand's incredibly important, right? But should we just use it on the brand side? And that's why I said that after Facebook, you can kind of look at everything as like specializing down the given funnel, right? You use it for very particular pieces, and you try to use these different networks holistically together in one solution. Just like I always recommend people see Google and Facebook not as combative in terms of budgets, but using them together, right? And then the last piece here is, will advertisers run video ads like they do on Facebook and YouTube? So very quickly, what does all this data mean? Facebook is the bell of the ball. You're starting to see that, right? In the social world, you really have them at the very top, and then everyone follows. CPMs are increasing across the board. You saw this on every single one of these different data dumps, right? Every network CPM increase, and you can see the numbers here. So 76% on Facebook, 11% on Twitter, and 18% on LinkedIn. This is the one where it's interesting to look at LinkedIn. CPCs are getting more expensive across the board. You can see the difference between these channels. You almost have an 8x growth over, you know, let's say Facebook versus LinkedIn. But again, it's all about those down funnel metrics. Every network, the CPC has also increased, 60% on Facebook, 18% on Twitter, and 15% on LinkedIn, right? Remember, this is a reasonable representation of these given audiences. CTRs are relatively flat across the board. We saw that in all three. So every single network, while at different volume sizes or different effectiveness levels, all exhibited the same trends. Social in general, as a holistic kind of vehicle, is showing you the exact same thing, just in slightly different flavors, right? Although those slightly different flavors can mean difference of like hundreds of millions of dollars, right? So CTRs, as mentioned, you can kind of see how they changed. Twitter's the only case where you actually had a decrease. Again, something kind of interesting for Twitter, but concluding thoughts. So advertisers, despite these increases in spend across the board, right? And this is just looking at two quarters. Just imagine if you look at the last 3 years, advertisers are still willing to pay for the increase in CPCs and CPMs, especially on Facebook, where results are measurable to some extent, right? LinkedIn still remains a consistent go-to for B2B marketers. The only thing that I urge you guys to make sure you have in place is don't spend on LinkedIn unless you're ready to measure. Unless you're ready to really dig in there, get connected to your CRM. If you're an agency, you need to urge your clients to be able to do that, or you're simply not gonna be able to show them the results they wanna see. And they'll really blame you at the end of the day, despite it being their fault on the measurement standpoint, right? And the final thing is Twitter is hanging around for the right type of advertiser. So those 50% of folks that it works for, they're hanging in there. We don't know what's gonna happen, especially with the member size kind of on a really flat or declining. And that's it, any questions?
All right. So in the interest of time, there is one question that we do have for you that I did want to ask. It's more about your platform specifically.
Okay.
So I think a lot of people are in the main platforms, Google, Bing, Facebook, Twitter, LinkedIn, as you showed there. There's an interest in wanting to know what the roadmap looks like for Snapchat and Pinterest on AdStage.
That's a good question. So on AdStage, I don't know. I personally am not necessarily, I know there's people here from probably both those companies, I apologize. I'm not necessarily the most bullish on Snapchat. The reason is more on the product side. Like I said, it doesn't necessarily matter if you just look at the auction. I think it's very important to look at the product itself, and I think there are certain challenges that I want to see played out between Facebook and Snapchat, or really Instagram and Snapchat, before we get invested there. We love the people there, they have a lot of smart people on the team, but it's something to keep in mind. Pinterest is another one of those, like I call it, you know, there's the primary networks, you have the secondary and the tertiary networks. Pinterest is a really good network if you're focusing on certain demographics, right? Female audience, shoppers, e-commerce, that world, where I think you're gonna start to see Amazon move into it as well. And so that's one that we'll pay attention to, especially if we move more into e-com. And then certainly you can think of networks like Amazon bringing in display through DoubleClick as well.
All right, great. Thank you very much.
Thanks guys, appreciate it.
Appreciate the time.